And so now we're going to talk about a specific type of writing, which is the narrative writing. So if you take a look up above by the ceiling, you see that all the different types of writing are up there. Okay? Okay, you have the exposition or expository type of writing, which is writing to inform. Then you also have persuasive writing, okay? Writing to construct an argument, okay? Not the type of argument that you're probably thinking of, okay? Then you have imaginative writing, writing to engage your creativity, which is very similar to what we'll be doing, narrative writing, writing to tell a story. Okay, but then there's also two last pieces of writing, and that's personal writing. Okay, writing to explore your own ideas. And then the last one is descriptive writing. Okay, writing to paint.
I told you that there were a bunch of different papers that I've written in my professional career, especially as a college student. And so here's all the different types of papers that I've written. I have, and this isn't even all of them, but this is majority of them. These are 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 page papers that I've written. So for instance, I brought in a lot of my writing just so you can see some of it. But for instance, we write for different purposes, just like we discussed. So this one was a personal writing. Okay, this is a letter that I wrote back when I was, I think, 19, it said on it, and I wrote this to my employer when I was working at Meijer. So I told you I started off at Meijer in the ninth grade, and I worked there for 9 years. So I said, I wrote this to one of the board members in the higher up part of the company. So I said, Dear Mr. Boyer, hi, my name is Raymond. And I'm an employee of Meijer 34. 34 signifies which location. It's the one in Royal Oak. I am 19 years of age, and I have been with Meijer for 4.5 years now. Meijer is my first and my only job. And for right now, I would like to keep it that way. But the working conditions at my store are very poor and are still decreasing. I like my job. I have some really good times there occasionally. So, and then I go on to list the different positions that I've had and what the issues are that I'm, and looking at this, it looks like what I was complaining about is my hourly wage. And so I was trying to, now that I'm looking at it further, I guess I was trying to actually persuade for my employers to increase the pay rate. Okay, so here's another writing piece that I did. This is when I was teaching 12th grade English at Wayne Memorial High School. And so I had to demonstrate how I wanted them to do their writing, to start off their writing. So I started off writing for them. And they just sat there and watched as I started writing my little piece so I would have an example for them. Okay, just to show them that I could do the same things that I needed them to do. So in my piece, I started off with lyrics from a Kelly Clarkson song. And I said, you know I dream in color and do the things I want. You think you got the best of me. Think you got the last laugh, but I bet you think everything good is gone. And then I say, these lyrics really speak volume over the theme of my life. There has been many times where I was obligated to defend my belief system against strong forces. Okay, so this was an example of me pulling in a hook as an attention getter in order to start off my paper. So you have to do something that is going to gain the reader's attention, because remember, primarily you are entertaining. People don't have to read your stuff. And then I'm going to get to your question in 1 second. So there's a host of other professional essays that I had to write for my class, my English and literature classes. There's a bunch of them that I had to write more over here. But here's one handwritten letter that I wrote in 2001, my freshman year of college, and I wrote this to one of my suite mates. So these are people who live next door to you, you know, in the dorms, next door to you. So I said, my suite mate across the hall was explaining to me one day how his professor didn't give him the grade on his assignment that he thought he should have gotten. And so I was telling him that I agreed with the professor. So I never submitted this to him. I said, "Dear Kyle, I'm sorry, but I really have to agree with your speech professor. Maybe I'll even go further than that. Than what she thought of the speech. And remember, if you really want a critic, here I am. From what you told me about your speech, I thought it was really stupid and immature." And then I go on to tell him why.
You look like a snappy wuzzle. He's like a bitch away. He like, damn, I fucked up.
That's probably why I didn't submit it, because I probably thought it would have hurt his feelings.
Came over there and whooped your ass.
Nah, he wouldn't have did that. He wouldn't have did that.
He lost his scholarship.
He had
to
run it. He had to run it.
No, that was my boy. We was cool.
No,
that was your
boy. The thing about me though.
That wasn't funny.
That was one laugh. That was your own laugh.
That was not funny.
But the thing about me though is I'm never afraid to disagree with people and get into a back and forth. That's why I want to eventually go into law, because I think lawyers have a really fun job. Even though I love teaching, but I think that's really fun. But the reason I wrote it down. It's not because I was scared to present it to him face to face. I wanted to make sure I got all my points down there, and that I'll be able to really give him a reason why. Because if I told it to him face to face, he would get offended immediately and probably cut me off before I gave him the points of why I thought it was a bad essay. Okay. He wanted to lower the consequences for underage drinking. So that means if you all start drinking right now, you won't get punished this bad according to the law. And I said, wow, that's stupid. You know, it's just, why don't they just, no, I was saying, why don't they just lower the age for drinking?
I'm already
drinking. Anyhow, so that's that.
Question. So you didn't add her name when you were quoting her lyrics. So did that plagiarism?
I read the whole age.
Actually, I didn't say it. I do have that's a good observation. So we shouldn't be having sidebar conversations. So Mr. Green was saying, isn't that plagiarism because I didn't have Kelly Clarkson's name in there? I did have it. I just didn't say it just for the sake of time. But it is, it's Clarkson in parentheses. Your objective was what, Jalen?
Our objective was to recall, identify, and apply the five major standards for writing a short story / narrative.
Okay, so that's exactly what we're going to do. The performance task. First, you're going to have to take notes on these five standards, so you're going to get introduced to them. Then you're going to have to identify them, and then you're going to apply them to a plot diagram. So just like we did a plot diagram for the necklace, you're going to also do a plot diagram for the student model story to show me you know how to dissect the story apart and you know its elements. Again, the success criteria is to get 80% or better. Points for you. So anyways, we're going to listen to Stan, and I want you to pay attention because we're going to discuss it afterwards.
I'll put these down. It's so funny.
Oh, yeah. Superman?
Nah, that's something funny too.
Okay.
We'll get to that afterward. Pay attention.
What the hell, you don't like it?
Okay, so this video and song came out probably exactly when you all were being born. It's really old. It's like towards the beginning of his career. I think it was on his first album, actually. And one of the fun things about teaching English is that all this stuff is literally comprised in the English curriculum. So I can use videos and movies and books and everything to illustrate my point of the lesson. So, let's go ahead and dissect what was going on here. So, Eminem is someone who you would call a narrative rapper. Okay, a narrative rapper because he tells a story in a lot of his songs. Now, a lot of his songs today, they try to accomplish different things so he can compete with other artists, but naturally at heart, I've always noticed that he likes to tell the story in a lot of his songs. So, what story was he trying to tell in this one?
About
a man who was writing
letters.
You said lyrics?
Letters.
A man who was writing letters to him. Who was the man?
Stan.
He wasn't just any man, he was a fan. Okay, so we have a character and we have a description. So who were the other characters? Were there any other characters?
Yes.
Who?
His brother.
His little brother.
His little
brother's name was what?
Matthew.
His girlfriend. Okay. Who else?
His mom.
The baby. You said his mom?
It was not cool.
It was like his mom. His family, his son.
Maybe it was.
I ain't gonna forget Eminem.
Right. Yeah, that's what I was looking for. I was looking for Eminem.
Yeah, you said it.
Oh, okay.
You trying to say something smart. Like, how are you gonna say that?
No, I didn't hear you say that. So yeah, Eminem. So we have our characters, and we have a main character, which is Stan. And so we know Stan's description is what?
Crazy dumb.
A crazy what?
Psycho.
Obsessed fan. Good. You said single.
Psycho.
A crazy obsessed psycho fan. Okay, so that's the main description of him, is that he's a fan, because that's what plays into the plot. So, what's the setting? Maybe an abandoned house.
It looked abandoned.
It looked like they're probably poor.
Okay, so probably they're probably of low income. So they're probably poor.
Early 2000s.
Thank you. I'm glad you were thinking of a time period. So the early 2000s. So it takes place in basically the time that it was made. It's probably an urban area. It's at night. Okay. It's raining. So let's get to the plot now. So what happens?
First off, he starts writing letters.
Then he changes his appearance.
We don't know if he met him first.
Did he meet him first?
Yeah, because that's what he said. He said when I met you. He said he writes letters, then he writes back.
Oh, okay. So he met him first. He started writing letters. He changed his hair color, his appearance.
He takes out that, and like he wasn't like. He was saying that he wasn't getting the letters and stuff like that. Like,
why didn't he get the letter?
Because I sent one.
Good. So you're paying attention. One fell out the mail hamper. Uh-huh. Okay. So that's why he wasn't getting it. So, but why did he think Eminem wasn't getting the letter?
Because he thought he was too good.
Because he'd been
writing back too quick, you know.
But why does Stan think that Eminem didn't write him back?
Because he's gone.
If I'm Stan, Eminem is not writing me back.
Oh, he's busy.
So what am I thinking about Eminem? I'm thinking that Eminem is not writing me back on purpose. That's what I'm thinking. Stan is thinking that Eminem is avoiding him on purpose. Okay? So, was Eminem avoiding him?
No.
No. He just wasn't getting the letters, and he was too busy. He was on tour. He's doing his thing. Okay, so like you said earlier, he formed an obsession, and his obsession started to turn into a sexual obsession also. Okay, and so You didn't think so?
He said it.
That's not what, I'm pretty sure that's not
what he said.
He said
even sometimes he's...
He might have a big bum, he want to be gay.
Jordan, he says it in the video when he was in the basement. Sometimes.
He said, I want us to be together, but I don't think that's what he meant.
Okay, so, and so I'm glad that Jordan brought that up. So, what clues, so we're trying to make one point, and Jordan isn't buying it. What clues can we use to prove it to Jordan that we're
because
right?
He got a tattoo on his chest.
He got a tattoo on his chest.
Obsession.
Okay.
He put their pictures together.
Good. He put a picture. He had a picture with his girlfriend. Okay. He took the picture of his girlfriend. He blocked the picture out with Eminem. Okay. And when his girlfriend saw it, she was disgusted by it. Okay?
And then he killed her.
And then he killed her. Okay.
He said... They blanked it out, but he said how he cut her throat open and stuff.
No, he said
in one of Eminem's songs, that's how Eminem illustrated that he did something like that. So, again, Eminem told a story about how he slit his girlfriend's throat, which if you know Eminem, you know that he hates his girlfriend.
He hated his wife, Kim. He hated his mom.
Yeah, her too. Okay. And, okay, so he, so, and also, because he mentioned multiple times that we could have been together, something else that he says. So, when Eminem finally did start writing back, he explained that, you know, I do want you as a fan. There's nothing personal against you. I don't know about this stuff about us being together. I don't personally agree with that. However, I do appreciate you, and hopefully you're not doing the crazy things that you're saying that you're doing. Because
he
it
was
just
doing
doesn't sound right.
Yo, yeah. As he was writing, he was doing.
Hold on.
Yeah, he was angry.
Okay, so his conflict that he established in that was one of rejection. He couldn't accept being rejected. How did he solve his conflict? Suicide.
He didn't kill himself really. He killed himself. No, he didn't.
He drove off a bridge to a lake and then picked up that morning. He's dead.
He was driving and it was a whole bunch of rain coming down. You know how the windshield wipers was moving.
He's going 90 miles an hour.
Let's,
he was high.
That'll make his point.
He was high.
Not you, Aaron. Let Cunique make his point.
But at the same time, I know he was driving fast, but at some time he was trying to like get away fast and stuff like that. I think so.
I see what you're saying, Kunik. So this is what happened.
Same thing would happen.
So this is what happened, Kunik. So once his girlfriend found the picture that he used to cover her up. She got disgusted, and he said, okay, you know what, enough of you, I'm getting rid of you. He put her in the trunk of the car, and
that's
he's,
what I'm saying.
But he's driving, and so now he's narrating on the video recorder for Eminem to hear, and he's saying, see, I'm not like you, I didn't, slit her throat, but she is in the trunk, like you did before. But then he says, okay, well, you know, I'm getting close to the bridge, so I gotta go ahead and cut this off. Wait a minute. I'm gonna get this out. You know, so he planned to drive over the bridge and kill himself, but he forgot.
At the same time, he wasn't.
He was. That was his objective. He wasn't driving anywhere else but to kill himself and his girlfriend. That's the only thing he was trying to accomplish there.
Together.
He just wanted to make sure that Eminem, that he probably should have stopped at the post office first to drop that that video recorder off, but he did mean to kill himself, and so that's how he solved his conflict. Okay, so that's what we're going to study. We're going to make sure that you create a story where you have all the other elements like characters and whatnot, but really I'm looking for a well-established plot and a solution to it, okay? And that you go in some type of a sequential order. You can add a character if you want to. You can put yourself in there as being, you know, super Dodo Bird or whatever, but you can steer it in whatever direction you want it to go into to end it. But what I'm going to be looking for are those pieces. So let's open up to 446 in your language network book.
That big thing. So what kind of conflict was this?
Was this external self-conflict? What?
That's a good question. So was this an external or an internal conflict?
Internal.
But I forgot what external and internal is. Ain't external outside.
Alright, external 446. Alright. You're fine. Alright, so external would be one of man versus nature, man versus machine, man versus basically everything else. But which one is internal? Man versus man. So it's man versus, no, I'm sorry, man versus himself. Man versus man is external, also going to be someone else. So which one was this one?
That would be man versus man, so that's external. Wait.
Internal, internal.
I think it was both. I think it was man versus himself, internal, because he was a little crazy, like we said. And then I think it was man versus a man, because he had an issue with Eminem.
It's all the same. It was like himself.
Writing to tell a story. So that's our main objective, is we're trying to successfully tell a story.
Outline the main events, describe the setting with visual details, create interesting characters, build toward an important turning point, resolve the conflict or problem in the story.
Awesome. Thank you. So we're going to study just that. So Jordan, at the top of page 446, can you go ahead and read for us? So we're going to learn what it is, the short story.
All right, short story. Learn what it is. Creative writing can take different forms depending on what you want to emphasize. Plot, characters, mood, language, or what you think will be the will best communicate your ideas.
Okay, so what we're doing is a form of creative writing. We're using our creativity to start writing. But it can have different forms depending on what we focus on. We can focus on plot, characterization, mood, language. We're focusing on plot. I'm sorry, continue.
This chapter will concentrate on the short story, but it'll also show how ideas can be expressed through poetry and drama.
Awesome. A short story is what, Jazz?
It's meant to entertain, but also explore ideas such as truth, right or wrong, or loyalty. You will find stories everywhere. Magazines, videos, ballads, books, and television.
Okay, so a ballad is a poetic song. So just like we saw here, we saw a short story in a song. So keep in mind that it's meant to entertain. So should you choose to become an author of some sort, that would be your job. If you don't entertain people enough that they want to buy your literature, then you fail. Okay, and so I am your audience and you are to entertain me. Okay. So, but I'm also going to be looking for the following things. So, short story at a glance. So, at the bottom, where it says standards for writing, Aaron, take the first one, and we're going to write these down. So, write down the those five bullet points, those five red bullet points, and the rubric. So, every writing piece has to have a rubric, because these are the standards that I'm going to be judging you and your work based on. So this is the criteria that you need to have fulfilled by the end lesson. No, not by the end of this hour, by the end of this lesson or this unit. Okay, so Aaron, a successful short story should what?
Use the eliminates of the character.
Elements?
Yeah, elements of character, setting and plot to create a thorough world.
Okay.
You should write the bullet points down?
Yes, we're writing down the bullet points. So, thank you. So, use the elements of character, setting, and plot to create a convincing world. Okay, so in your exposition, in your introduction, you're going to use all those things, which you're going to already have your characters.
Okay, and whoever you decide to include in there.
Okay, you're going to basically have your setting. But you can also exchange the setting for another one if you want to. But remember, just like we discussed yesterday, you might have to study up on something, do a little bit of research if you change your setting. Because if you change it to something that you don't know about, you need to study up on it first to make it convincing, a convincing world.
Exactly.
Second bullet point, Cohen. A successful short story should what?
Should use the elements of character, setting, and plot to.
That was the first one we read, that one.
Use vivid sensory language skills. Concrete details and dialogue to create believable characters, etc.
Okay, whenever you're creating a story, you should be able to show as opposed to tell. So you use what they call sensory language, which means that people can use their senses on it. Okay, so just like we study abstract and concrete nouns, okay, the abstract ones will be the ones at the top where it says that it may also explore ideas such as truth, right or wrong, or loyalty. Okay, and that's how, that's what guides basically your entire short story. That's like the moral, the background of the story. But in your description of things, you need to use sensory language. Baking a sweet potato pie. Okay, so that right there, anyone who smelled a sweet potato pie, their senses are starting to work, figuratively smelling that scent. Okay, so you should be able to show instead of just tell. And you use dialogue. So your characters need to talk. They need to have some type of conversation with one another. Third one. Nakaya, what's the third one? A successful short story should what?
Developing, resolving, conflict.
Yeah, good. Okay, so just like we discussed, you need to develop an issue. So just when they thought it was over, this happened, you know, and then you need to bring some type of a resolution to it. I'll present a clear sequence of events is the next one, and you need to take the last one. Good. Just make it so that one person is telling the story, the same person. Okay. Hey, please, keep it up.
Wow, Mr. Kelly, your lessons are really good when I pay attention.
Hi, welcome to this Teachlet on Tone and Mood. The essential question, what is the difference between tone and mood? A lot of times, as students, we might get confused on tone and mood, and we also use them interchangeably a whole lot of times. But the thing is they're two different things, and they're relating to two different parts of a story, and there's two different groups of people affected by the tone and the mood, and it's important to know what the tone is versus what the mood of the story is. The tone is the author's attitude about their topic, characters, or audience. We see tone develop through the author's choice of words, and we can also see it sometimes through the author's bias and opinion on the topic. If the author is writing a speech, we can get the author's tone based on what they feel about their topic, what it is they're describing, what it is they're presenting, what their speech is about. We can also see it through their choice of words. What kind of words are they choosing? Are they choosing words that have a positive feel to them? Do they have words that seem negative? What kind of punctuation marks are they using at the end? Are they using lots of exclamation points to get their point across? Also, authors can occasionally use all caps and to show extreme emotion. So, author's tone is the attitude the author has about their topic, characters, or audience. In a fictional piece, the author may show their tone through the character's actions, the things that they do, the things the characters say, how they develop the characters to get an idea of the author's attitude. So tone focuses on the author's attitude. It's kind of like when you're young, you may hear your parents say, "Watch that tone of voice with me." It means watch your attitude. Watch how you say the words you're saying to your mom or to your dad. Some example words to describe tone: amused, angry, cheerful, horror, clear, formal, gloomy, optimistic, witty, serious, playful. Emotion words. What words describe attitudes? These are just a few words. There's lots more. If you Google tone words on the internet, there will be a whole slew of words that come up that help you describe tone. So tone are those adjective words. What words describe emotions and feelings? Let's look at an example of how we might see tone as a question. Let's read this short passage. A gift in his shoes. Donovan and Larry were early for baseball practice. They decided to run up and down the bleachers to exercise before the rest of the team arrived. Larry was first to the top. He whispered to Donovan, "Look over there." He pointed to a man sleeping on the highest narrow bench of the bleachers. His pants and shirt were faded, worn, and too large for his thin frame. One big toe stuck out of the huge hole in his sock. His scraped-up shoes sat a few feet away. Donovan whispered, "We should help him out. Let's hide something good in his shoes. Then when he wakes up, he will have a nice surprise." So be thinking, what is the author's tone? What is the author's attitude towards the man, towards the old man in the bleachers? So how would you describe the author's tone, the author's attitude? Would you describe his or her tone as angry, detached, and sympathetic? Did the author seem angry towards the old man or towards the two boys in this story? Did they describe anything as yelling or being unjust or unfair? Were they detached? Did they show no feelings or emotions at all? Did the author have the boys just ignore the old man and pay no attention to what he looked like or how what situation he might be in? Or were they sympathetic? Did they feel sorry for the man? Did they want to do what they could to help him? And so the best answer would be sympathetic. And your evidence would be the fact that they looked at the old man. They saw what he looked like. They saw his clothes were torn. He was thin. He was frail. They also saw that an opportunity had arisen that they could put something in his shoes so when he woke up, he would have a nice surprise. So that's the evidence to support that sympathetic would be the best tone for this author.
All right, so I'm going to pause the video right here just to make a comment. I disagree with her answer, but I do like this video. I love this video on doing the compare and contrast between tone and mood. That's why I'm showing it. However, I disagree with her answer. So based on our options and looking at the question, I would pick B, detached, for the author. So the question says, how would you describe the tone or attitude of this author? Not the character, but of the author. So if we go back, since we're looking for evidence, if we go back to the actual passage, I don't have any issue with saying that Donovan is sympathetic because, you know, he wants to help out the homeless person sleeping on the bleachers, and that's great. But if we look at what, you know, the author is saying, we don't have to assume right here that this is Donovan speaking. This is probably just the author, you know, the author's point of view. So the author is describing the person who's sleeping on the bleachers, and he says, he pointed to a man. So we know that this is not Donovan because it says he. So we're in third person. So he pointed to a man sleeping on the highest narrow bench of the bleachers. That's fine. Now we get a description of the man. His pants and shirt were faded. Hey, okay, you know, we're getting into a little, I don't know, it's a little disrespectful to kind of, you know, tear this man apart and how he's looking. But his pants and shirt were faded, worn, and too large for his thin frame. So they're like ripping this guy apart. You know, he looks terrible. His pants and shirt were faded. The color is gone. They're worn out, raggedy clothes. He's skinny and decrepit. You know, like these words, you know, don't help for the sympathy that we're trying to answer for. So then it says, one big toe stuck out of the huge hole in his sock. His scraped up shoes sat a few feet away. You know, it's like if we were speaking for Donovan, okay, I can say that he is sympathetic. But for whoever is telling this story, you know, this is from a third person point of view. This person is not sympathetic. This person is detached because of the words. Once again, like she said, the words that they are using. So I would pick for the author B, detached. But for Donovan, the character, I would pick sympathetic. That's all.
Okay, tone focuses on the author, while mood focuses on the reader. The mood is the feeling the reader gets from reading the text. You see mood develop through the setting and the atmosphere or the text of the story. So what's the setting? What's going on around the story? What are the events happening? What's the effect of the events? So the mood affects the reader. Tone affects the author. It's the author's attitude. The reader's has the feelings, and that's the mood. So the difference between tone and mood, tone is the author's attitude, while mood is the reader's feelings. Some example words you might see to describe mood are very similar to the same words you would see to describe tone. Lonely, suspenseful, painful, peaceful, joyous, violent, gloomy. So think about when you watch movies. How do those movies make you feel? So mood is how you feel. I'm in a bad mood because your tone is so rude. So tone is the attitude, while mood is the feeling. So let's look at that same story. I'll read it again. And now this time, let's think, what mood does this story put me in? How do I feel when I get done reading this story? Donovan and Larry were early for baseball practice. They decided to run up and down the bleachers to exercise before the rest of the team arrived. Larry was the first to the top. He whispered to Donovan, "Look over there." He pointed to a man sleeping on the highest narrow bench of the bleachers. His pants and shirt were faded, worn, and too large for his thin frame. One big toe stuck out of his huge hole in his sock. His scraped up shoes sat a few feet away. Donovan whispered, "We should help him out. Let's hide something good in his shoes. Then when he wakes up, he'll have a nice surprise." So how does this story make you feel? Does it make you feel angry? Does it make you feel detached? Or does it make you feel sympathetic? And what evidence do you have to support how you feel? In this case, it makes me feel the same way. I feel sympathetic. I feel sorry for the old man. I want to be able to help him. Why do I feel sympathetic? Because the mood helps me feel as though I want to help that old man. I want to help him out. I want to be able to do something too. And I also feel sympathetic because I see what the boys are doing to help the man. So again, to review, tone is the author's attitude. Mood is how the reader feels. Tone, think about how your parents might say, "What's your tone of voice? What's your attitude?" Versus, "What mood are you in? How are you feeling today? I'm in a great mood. I'm in a horrible mood." So tone is the author. Mood is the reader. Tone is attitude. Mood is feeling. Thank you so much for joining me for this Teachlet today. Thank you.
Top of page 447. All right, here we go. Frank found it hard to concentrate on his homework with a fleet of Kraxons chasing after them at just over warp 37. Okay, what was the collective noun in that sentence? Fleet of Kraxons. So we studied collective nouns 2 weeks ago, and an example of it is right there. Fleet of Kraxons. Q-11 was a great pilot, but the Kraxons were great marksmen, and the ship rocked with their laser fire. Paragraph number two. "Are you sure we're not going to get killed?" Frank asks, bending over to pick up his pencil. Trying to finish his homework neatly in Q-11's XP-38 was even more impossible than trying to finish it on the bus.
I got a question, Mr.
Kendrick. All you have to do is raise your hand. Question.
What is that? Like, is it like a meaning of those? Like with the letters and the numbers?
Okay. So, what do we think that an XP-38 is?
A pencil.
We think an XP-38 is a pencil?
No, it sounds like it's a gun or something.
Okay, so let's try it again. Trying to finish his homework neatly and Q-11's XP-38 was even more impossible than trying to finish it on the bus. So what's the comparison?
You said
bus ride. So like
it's supposed to be like some type of vehicle.
Exactly, because we're comparing the bus to something. So it's some type of a vehicle. What type of vehicle do you think that it is?
Sounds like a Land Rover.
No,
it's
not
a
Land Rover. You know, the thing that
going
it's
hard.
A boat, because it said the ship
walk.
Okay,
but what? In that first
paragraph,
it
says
the ship walk.
But what did we say that Q11 was?
A vehicle.
It said easy.
I thought
it was like a Okay, so this is why we have to pay attention. From the top. Okay, so the title is called Frank and the Guy from Planet 20. Frank found it hard to concentrate on his homework with a fleet of Kraxens chasing after them at just over warp 37. Q-11 was a great pilot, but the Kraxens were great marksmen, and the ship rocked with their laser fire. "Are you sure we're not going to get killed?" Frank asked, bending over to pick up his pencil, trying to finish his homework neatly, and Q-11's XP-38 was even more impossible than trying to finish it on the bus. "Don't worry," Q-11 said. "We're just 2 light years from the wormhole. The Kraxens won't follow us through there." "That's good, because this wormhole will take us back to our galaxy in about a third of the time it would take under normal hyperspace." "Oh." Frank still didn't get half of what Q-11 said, but he liked him, and he liked spending his lunchtime with Q-11 like this. The ship rumbled, and Frank broke the tip off his pencil. "Rats! Are we in trouble?" "Nah, not really. We just lost 10% engine efficiency. We might be slightly late for class." "That was okay?" "Well, no, that's not a question. That was okay. History was the first class after lunch, and kids were usually late for it." Frank looked out the window and saw a blue spiraling cloud with millions of white dots being sucked into it. "Is that our wormhole?" "Yep," said Q-11. "Sorry, you cracks and dopes. Time for me to hand in my history homework." They were swirling into the blue cloud. The world outside the ship stretched itself into a single ray of light that shot off into the distance. They rode this ray at a staggering speed. Q-11 spun in his chair. "Was that fun or what?" "Yeah, it was," Frank said. "It's always fun." Things had quieted to a point where he might get some work done. "Give me a hand. I forgot what she means when she says, manifest destiny. It's like when American settlers moved west and conquered the Indies, or the Indians who were in their way. Survival of the fittest, as the Kraxens would say." Frank looked up when he was finished writing. "How come you're so good at history?" "I like learning about your planet. It's interesting. Earth's history is a lot more complicated than Planet 20's history." Could anyone find the possessive noun in that previous sentence?
Wait, what? Repeat yourself.
Could anyone find the possessive noun in that previous sentence? Earth's history is a lot more complicated than Planet 20's history. And?
History.
And Planet 20's. So Earth's? How do we know that Earth's is a possessive noun?
Because it's so possessed with the apostrophe S.
With the apostrophe S, but it could be a contraction. How do we know that it's possession?
Because it's talking about something. It's talking about something.
History, right. Because it's saying that something belongs to Earth. It's showing ownership of history. Okay. Russell, one number one. What? Frank asked. "You guys have been around eons longer than us." "Yeah, that's true, but we're a lot less complicated. On Planet 20, there is only one culture, so our history is much simpler. But on your own small planet," Frank shot a frown at Q-11. "Hey, what's that? It's bigger than Venus." Frank realized that that wasn't saying much. Shut up! I like my planet. Q11 sighed. I like it too. I'm saying that you've got a heck of a lot to see on that one tiny planet. I'll accept that, Frank said. 10 minutes later, they were in orbit around Earth. Frank waved his right arm in frustration. What time is it? My watch stopped in that time tunnel. Wormhole, Q11 said. In town, it's 12:34. Cool, Frank said. He looked at Q11. I still don't get how we can spend a day playing in space and still get back to Earth about half an hour after we left. Don't worry, Q11 said. It's science. Geez, said Frank. What isn't? The two friends got into the transporter and appeared behind a group of trees in the schoolyard 30 seconds before the bell rang. They ran inside and handed in their homework to Mrs. Travers. Or maybe it's Travers, whichever one. Okay, so. Thank you.